There's a lot of different options in order to store data for your iOS application. I found it a little bit difficult in the beginning to understand why are there so many options and which one should I use for what. So I want to give you an overview of some of the different options. It's definitely not all of them, because especially when I move on to the more advanced storages like servers or serverless options like Firebase, probably not going to mention everything. So in case you have more that you want to mention, please leave a comment in the comment section. And also, especially if you have used it before, because it would be very informative if you can also talk about your experience with these different options. So I'm just going to go through all of them and the reasons why you might want to choose one or the other, or what are skills that you actually need to handle all this. So you have kind of an idea of what to expect if you actually want to build a bigger project or if you want to work in a company. For example, you would need to be able to work with Codable and also have an understanding of how to create your data models. So let's start by the first consideration, which is what is the data that you want to save? And in this case, I'm talking about, is it something simple, like one value at a time? For example, the user settings. When I'm here in Xcode, choosing the theme, the presentation style, the one value that I'm actually setting here, the presentation style, this value would be great to save in user default because it's just one value. You would never save multiple of them. So always use this one. In case your simple data is very precious and you want to make sure that it's secure, then the other option is to use the keychain. This is nice because it's also sync between different devices. One example is Firebase. So it seems that when you log in a user, the user account is stored, or the ID is the login token, whatever they save, is stored in the keychain, because then they can always restore it when the application is launched the next time. In case your data becomes a little bit more complex, it's not just one value. For example, here in my theme picker, each of these themes consists of different fonts for different types or text snippets that you want to use. And you see we are storing here the fonts and the spacing and the color for all of them. And we have all of these themes in a list. So this is an example where you probably would have a document for all of these themes. And each of these documents, you have the different types as a key and then the font as the values. And it's quite limited because I'm just here picking one of these themes and loading the corresponding document with the settings or the fonts. So it's rather simple data, but you have a little bit more data that you want to keep nicely together in each of these documents. One of the types you might encounter if you want to implement this is UI document. Also, if you are creating a document-based application, a new project with a document, you see an implementation of UI document. The most important, most common type that you should definitely be aware of is JSON, especially if you want to work with web APIs. And a great tool is Codable, because it helps you to take your Swift code and create a JSON with it. I'm talking here in the next one about data models. Then the example with the themes it's quite straightforward. But sometimes you have some relationships or things that are connected. For example, you have a online store with all the products and all the users and the orders. So you have a lot of different data things and a lot of them. If it's getting bigger, you don't want to have one document. In order to query, to search something in the document, you have 10 documents and you're looking for a specific tag. In order to search that, you would need to load all of these 10 documents. It's getting heavy in the sense of size of your data and also computational effort. You don't want to do too much work. One way of dealing with more complex data is to go for databases. And especially if you're growing, you need to be aware of performance optimization. But this is probably not what you have to worry too much when you're a front-end developer. But it's more the other side of the spectrum. So now we talked about what kind of storage types you might want to use. The other thing is you need to define a data model. That means you need to describe the information that your user, your UI is consuming in a Swift way. So we need to deal with the types, because some of the things that you want to show are not Swift-y. So it's like a Lego system. All of your types are little Lego pieces, and in order to create something more complex, you have to deal with, you have to assemble and decide on what of pieces you want to put together. So an important thing is to have and be aware of all the types that you have in Swift. So I did write here a couple of them. And so we go for strings, integers, bool, dates, URLs, UIDs. We also have some special ones that are specific depending on what UI you are having. For example, I have here UI image. UI is UI kit, something very UI kit like. How do you store the two disk? What is enum types, which are really Swift? When you define your data models and you look at all those types, for example, you're going to want to store this data to JSON. I already mentioned Codable. This is a protocol. And you get a very simple way of working with JSON once you understand this Codable protocol, and also where how do you know you are allowed to use it with Codable. So I'm going to open the developer documentation. So you can use the search bar and look for Codable. And functionally, usually you see all the types that conform to Codable. So I have to click here on Decodable and see here all the types that are conforming to this type. So for example, we can use CGPoint to store this. Here, all of these different integer types, a URL, UUID. So these are all the Lego pieces that you can use to define your data types, your data model. So we have a your information that the user wants to consume, going to types that you have in Swift, going to types that you can easily store as a JSON. But maybe you don't want to just store it to disk with JSON. Maybe you want to send it to a server and the server doesn't know about CGPoint. Or you want to work with core data and core data doesn't work with CGPoint. You have to deal with all these types depending on what service you're using, how you store it. For example, MongoDB Realm doesn't work with Float, so you have to go back to doubles. And this Lego putting things together, you can see an example with CGPoint. A point consists of a X and Y position, and you can these two values you can save as two separate values as a double. So you can still store it in core data. It's just a how do you work with the data, the information that you want to store, and make it work with the system that you're choosing. The other thing about data models is how do you keep information together that belongs logically together? So you just saw me discussing the fact of an Xcode, the theme. So for example, a font consists of the weight, is it bold, a size, or the style, the type. So you would always have a type that in itself, inside the type, has these three properties that it depends on. So it's kind of nested data. And this makes it easy to work with because you're just asking, oh, I want to know if the font is bold. You can just ask the property of this font. Sometimes you don't want to nest the data inside too much because it might get too big, and then relationships come in handy. But this is again the situation where you're probably looking for a database. So now that we talked about data models, the question is now where? So we have now seeing the complexity is important and how do you describe it in the right context? Or is it in Swift, in core data, in JSON that you want to use with a server? And now it's the question of where is actually stored, because it's a document-based application, you probably are just like, oh, I want to store my data locally. I guess also with the Xcode themes, they are probably stored in the bundle. But since I can change, so you can shipping the default themes in the bundle, but since I can actually customize all the fonts, I might need to copy them to disk where the user can change them from there on. I still need to, when I change here a color or something, I need to store this. So I would need to have this stored locally. It doesn't really make sense to store somewhere else as a single document. So this is a great example of local storage and working with the file manager. In this context, you also need to understand the sandbox, the concept of sandbox on iOS, which restricts the access of your application to other data. So your data, your application is only allowed to store data in a specific location in your sandbox, which makes it easy to delete your application and all the data it belongs to. And it also makes it safe because it doesn't mess up everything. This is very different to macOS, because in the macOS application, you might want to load a file from anywhere in the file system. So in this case, this access restrictions doesn't make sense. As a difference between iOS and macOS, you can easier ship an iOS application to macOS because the iOS application is used to a restricted area where you can store things. So they can just dedicate a similar thing as a sandbox on macOS. But if you want to transfer a macOS app, which expects to have access to all your files, if it's a Node app that you can just store anything and you want to ship that on iOS or iPadOS, somebody needs to think of how to store data. Now on iPadOS we have a file, so I'm not really sure if they're going to allow this or not, but this seems to be one of the reasons why it's not so easy to ship macOS apps on iOS. But iOS apps on Mac is really easy, which they actually do now for as a default for the Macs with an M1 chip. Okay, so now going back to the topic, we have local storage in a file-based way. You can also store SQLite files or images, whatever you want. There is a way of sharing your data between different devices by using the iCloud storage. If you want to try this for iCloud, you need to have a paid developer account. So you can try to use CloudKit in this case. If you want to work with a database, something more complicated, then Core Data is very useful because you can do some advanced querying and searches. One thing that Core Data can allow you in the background is to use a SQLite database. Core Data is quite popular. It's even more important, I think, in the sense that once you worked with Core Data, the skill that you gain from this is how to define your data models and how to connect different data together with these relationships. These are the types you can store locally. Then I already mentioned the iCloud, which is the Apple platform option to sync data between different devices. So you can, as long as you stay on an Apple device, you can sync the data. It's not so expensive. There is a generous free tier which scales with the amount of users you have. So you can have a look at this. But nowadays it's probably even more important to consider cross-platform, because most of us might not only target Apple users. Then we have to look outside of the Apple universe. The more advanced solution would be a web service. So having your own server, or if you work in a company, somebody, a backend engineer who's taking care of the server, who tells you how to consume, what kind of data is provided, and what kind of responses and endpoints to use. This is definitely one thing that you need to understand when you're looking for a job. And again, we have here JSON. This is the file format of the internet. In case you have a web service, you will not have offline support. So even if you have a shopping app and the user is offline, they might still want to see their shopping cart, what they actually ordered. So you need to be able to store some of the data that you're fetching from the internet locally, maybe the last searches or something. One solution for this is to use Core Data, because then you have a local storage solution. So this is again another reason why Core Data is popular. So you fetch your data, you store it in Core Data, and from the UI perspective, you're fetching it from the Core Data stack. In case you're not so advanced and you don't want to be a full stack developer, or you don't have another backend developer, like for your own projects, it might be a better option to use a serverless option. One thing to look into is Firebase. One learning outcome, at least if you're just trying it, is to understand how the authentication works. What's the options? But it's definitely a good idea to look at the documentation. Like Firebase has quite a big documentation, so you can have a look at how to do the authentication, how to set up things. I do mention here MongoDB and Realm because for my personal project I'm using this, and also the document that you see here actually is from my personal project. So it's basically indirectly you're seeing here Realm at work. Realm was acquired by MongoDB like 2 years ago, some time ago, and they now seem to get through the transition time. since they get acquired, some people were hesitant to use Realm because it wasn't sure if they would support it in the future or not. So this is also one thing to keep in mind. Firebase is probably not going to go away because it's from Google. They are extending more and more of these features. Realm, now what I saw from the documentation and the features they added, they definitely extended the functionality of Realm to work with MongoDB, and this seems to be a very powerful database. But it is nice to scale database if you know how to define the schema. So this is referring to the fact when you have here some scaling issues, how do you define your schema? It scales nice, you don't have huge documents that you have to load all the time, and you don't do too much computational work on your server. One thing I liked about Realm is I did learn quite a bit about the how to model data. So if you want, you can have a look at their documentation website. Even if you don't want to use it, it's quite a good resource to how to describe data models with relationships. The other thing that you might want to consider when you choose a serverless backend is what kind of features you need. So I already mentioned authentication. This is because you're having data of a lot of people and you don't want to let one user mess up everybody else's data, because data is precious. So authentication is a big thing, also access control. So you should be able to define the rules for which user is allowed to read which data and who is allowed to change data. For example, if you have Twitter, obviously you want to be able, all of the users should be allowed to see all of the other people's profiles. So this would be public data to read, but definitely not to write. So only the user whose profile this is should have write access there. Then a feature that I start to get into more is functions. So both Firebase and MongoDB have this. You can simply call a function from your end user. This is especially interesting if you have some situations where the user doesn't have read-write access to all everything, but you have a function that you just want to have a teeny tiny little bit, like you have a database where you don't want to let the user see all of the other users, but maybe he wants to search for a different person to invite them to collaborate or something. So you wouldn't allow the user to search all these documents, because then you see all the data. Maybe you have a function there that you can call to search for a specific name of a user, and then this function inside on your server is running to search for all the database. And then retrieves only the result of, is this actually an existing one? Or if there is a user that exists, maybe he wants to send an invite to the other person without actually exchanging too much data. Then there's another cool feature, which is triggers. There's quite a few examples for triggers. For example, you have a lot of users and some people are not happy with your application, so they might opt out after some time. And you are having their data, but you don't really want to keep everybody's data. It would just cost you money to store all of this. So if you want to regularly run some functions, so here again, you would use functions. So you have a trigger of when the user is logging out or is deleted in a database, then maybe you want to clean up their data. Or if a new user exists, maybe you want to start having a document with all their settings. Maybe you want to prepare the data for them. So there's quite a few nice triggers that you might want to consider. This is really at the other end of the spectrum, but it's nice if you at least be aware of their existence. With this, I want to finish the overview of data persistence in iOS. And I hope you got some ideas of options like user defaults, keychains, and the documents and the file manager, core data, cloud kit, URL session to work with the servers, and obviously here your data formatting with JSON and Codable, and also some serverless options like Firebase and MongoDB. In this case, you gain the possibility to share data between different devices, different platforms even, and increasing the complexity, but it definitely is more work to do. So you always should be aware of, don't store a simple value in a document in the file system if you can use user defaults, or don't use core data if it's just one value. That would be maybe a little bit too much, but it always depends on your specific use case. Deciding on this is going to get a lot easier the more you use these different options. You might even in the beginning try to use different ones for the same and then decide on their own. It's pretty big learning curve. And you don't need to be good at all of them. You're going to be an expert on the specifics depending on the job you are in. If you found this video helpful, give it a like. In case you want to see more about a specific topic, leave a comment and I will see if I can answer your question, or if it's a little bit more complex than just answering it in a comment, I might also do a tutorial about this. Because this is quite a lot of ground to cover. Have fun coding. See you next time.